gospel done, right? You've watched it, you've had a chance to meditate on it. And other things, other Bible studies, things like that. Ton of great, great resources if you want more sermons. This project 1517, though, just wanted to say a quick thing about this. So, this is a podcast that's, there's two twins that are pastors that do this podcast. And so the kind of novelty of it is you got these twins that are kind of quirky and funny, and but they're both ridiculously well-trained pastors. They're both brilliant guys, and so they discuss books of the Bible in kind of short form. So it's 20 minutes, and they'll do maybe 3 or 4 verses, 10 verses of a book of the Bible, and they slowly make their way through the Bible. So the first book they did was Amos. Was that the first one they did? Yeah, all right. Amos was season 1. Season 2 was Jude. Season 3, they're doing Jonah right now. Funny story. So they called it Project 1517. They got a cease and desist email or letter in the mail from a group that had copyrighted the year 1517. And telling them that they needed to desist from using that in their title. Now, obviously, this would not stand up in court in any way, shape, or form. But they started this podcast simply as a way of getting a few extra resources in for their members and their congregations, extra stuff for them to do. And it's just taken off. It's gotten much larger. They've got a following of 1,000 or something like that now that are subscribed to their podcast and stuff like that. So it's going really well for them. And so with this cease and desist letter, they decided, well, we're just going to do kind of a rebranding thing as well. So they're going to change the name from Project 1517 to something a little bit more open for, that's not quite so specific, kind of Lutheran sounding, because what's 1517? Lutheran. Yeah, right, that's the nailing of the 95 Theses, right? And so the idea is to kind of make it a little bit more broad as well. But, so here's the interesting part. One of the next seasons that they're going to do, they are trying to kind of broaden out and make things a little bit wider as far as who's involved in the project. And they asked me and Kent Reeder to do a season of this. And so we agreed to it. And the season that we're doing, the book of the Bible we're doing, is 1 John. So I have been researching 1 John for the last 2 months. And putting together this Bible study that we've got right now. And so you are my guinea pigs, so to speak, to kind of help me work through this material and work through it, have some fun together, and just kind of give me some of your wisdom and resources and feedback as we kind of put together this podcast. So I'm doing it with a guy named Kent Reeder, who's down in North Carolina. And so, in fact, he's been here before. He's a good friend of St. Paul. So we're not twins, so hopefully we'll kind of have the deep south and kind of the Canadian cultural stuff going on, which should make it kind of interesting as well. But so that's one of the interesting things here. And so the Bible study we are doing today, Darkness Passing, I am obviously then very excited to get to do this with you. 1 John is an amazing, amazing book of the Bible. We spent a good 3 months together going through Ecclesiastes, and what was the theme of Ecclesiastes? Yeah, without God, everything is meaningless, and so Solomon spends chapter after chapter after chapter making it as clear as possible that if we do not consider this world within the meta-narrative of the gospel, within the meta-narrative of God's salvation plan, if you are just looking at the world as it is, this is a meaningless place. 1 John is a very useful thing for us to study right after it, because if we were to come up with a theme for 1 John, it might be everything is meaningful. All of a sudden, all of life, we're going to see different aspects, relationships, all of it injected with that gospel motivation becomes a beautiful, beautiful world for us Christians to live in. The theme, Darkness Passing. If you look at the very back of your folders here, the color back there, I've got the quote with it where that's from, 1 John 2:8 there. And so this is just one of his beautiful lines that's in this. I am writing you a new command. Its truth is seen in him. Who do you think the him is? Jesus, right? The truth is seen in Jesus and in you, because the darkness is passing and the true light is already shining. And that is the world that Christians live in, not an infinite darkness of meaningless, as Solomon clearly proved this world is without God, but we live instead in a world of darkness passing. It's passing. We do not live in the sheer light of the world, right? Everything is not perfect, but we know that the darkness is passing, and that passing was brought about because of what Jesus has done for us. And so 1 John is going to be this beautiful treatise that John has to kind of help us work through this. Our first lesson then, complete joy. We'll get to that in a minute. What I want to do first, though, is, you remember that artist Full of Eyes? I've done a couple of his videos before. I like his stuff. He's got a new video, and I want you to tell me what you think of it, all right?
Hold me in Sure.
Yeah. Yep. Good. Other thoughts?
Deep.
The lyrics were not designed for the video.
Oh, okay.
So instead, the video highlighted just refrains and things like that.
A lot of symbolism, and clearly, at some point, I think you want a discussion of that, so there's no misinterpretation.
Yeah, like what?
Well, there's just a lot of things going on there. You can read into it. I interpret it a certain way. Am I right? It makes for an interesting discussion, Paul.
Yeah.
I also agree with Judy. The singer, it's melodic, but he's sort of into that. It's not clearly understood, and that's unfortunate, so you need the captions.
Yep.
But other than this.
It took a while to figure out what things were going on.
Yeah. Well, what was going on? What was going on?
Jesus, why you blood of Minas, right?
This has something to do with communion, right? And what is the message of the video with communion?
Forgiveness.
Yeah, forgiveness.
It's a journey.
It's a journey, right? So at the end, you see the bread continually breaking, right? And the Christian continually being renewed. Yeah. I think that's the visual goal there, right at the end of it. What does the artist seem to be telling us that communion is? Yeah, how do you get away from not thinking that, right, watching this video? Mm-hmm. I do not know if this guy is a Lutheran. I do not think he is. He's just a Christian that does art. But you watch this, and as a Lutheran, a means of grace, sacrament-driven Lutheran, there's some pretty cool stuff going on in here, right?
Shows a lot of blood in it, more so than the bread.
Yeah, it shows a lot more blood than the bread. I think that's for visual effect. So what this author, or what this artist tries to do in his work is he takes very abstract concepts that are taught in Scripture, and he's trying to visually display them, right? So this idea of you and I being washed in the blood of Christ, right? That sounds grotesque, right? To our kind of 21st century ears, and he's trying to visualize exactly what that means for you and I in an artistic and beautiful way. And it's no doubt, right, that the blood from communion there, or the wine from communion, right, that this is directly correlated with the blood of Christ.
Is it geared towards Christians?
It's definitely geared toward, well,
because a non-Christian wouldn't know what's going on there.
No, right, no. Yeah. This, I mean, the non-Christian would not know what's going on here in the same way that Ethiopian eunuch reading Isaiah 53 would not know what's going on, right? But that doesn't mean that the Ethiopian eunuch is not curious about what in the world is going on, right? He just needs someone to explain it to him, right? And that's our job. Yeah, so the other kind of thing, how much of a renewed and sanctified life is dependent on the person versus Christ in here? Did you notice that?
Well, clearly the person is like lifeless.
Yeah.
You see it there like that, and it's God who's drawing them.
Yeah. Yeah. Right, you've got a black charred corpse there at the communion table, and then communion is literally a means of grace. What do we mean when we say a means of grace? What's that a churchy word for? What do we say when we say that God's word and his sacraments are means of grace?
The elements and God's word.
What's a means of grace? What's the definition of a means of grace? You're right. What's that?
It's the forgiveness of sins.
Yeah, it gives the forgiveness of sins. It is the means through which you receive God's grace. In other words, is that this is the means through which you get the forgiveness of sins, and God has not revealed any other means other than the means of grace of his word. That's the only way that you can get God's grace, as far as we know. And so communion is not something that you are doing for Christ. It's not your way of showing your thankfulness of Christ, but instead it is him giving you his grace. And that is powerfully pictured, I think, especially in that communion scene where you've got the corpse at the end of the table and it's Christ's hand reaching out through the cup, right? His blood, literally. You see the Christian being raised, right, by the Holy Spirit, right? Obviously a picture of God's grace working through it. So I think it's a fabulous video. If obviously there's lots that, you want to pull every little piece apart, but he's trying to take complex ideas and share them to us. But what I'm kind of especially interested in here is, let's see here, I want to go all the way. So, Christmas cheer during this Bible study. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord that they may have compassion on them. And so what's interesting is that you read these passages, and let's say you've never read any other Bible passage whatsoever. This is the first thing that you've ever read. What would you assume is the way that a person gets saved? Yeah, right, that you have to do it, right? That you have to forsake your ways and that you have to forsake your unrighteous thoughts, right? And that you are making the step forward. Now, is that what Scripture teaches in total?
No.
No, what's going on here?
Decision, theology.
Well, this is a quote from the script. This is a quote from the Bible.
Oh.
This is from the Bible.
He's making a thought that this is what I've done for you. This is what you need to do to show that you're not for me.
And how are Christians able to do that? How are Christians able to forsake? You're absolutely right.
Only through Jesus that we can do that. But we love God, so we want to not do the evil that we have to do, you know?
Yeah, right. So think of the video again. The whole video, as far as I can tell, has been gospel from start to finish. God is doing everything. Jesus is doing everything. And through the work of the Holy Spirit, through His Word and His work on your heart, Christians are able to forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. The gospel, or the letter of John that we have here, John's first epistle. What's interesting about it is that you could find half a dozen, two dozen verses that if you just took them in isolation, they would look just like this, where it looks like there's something you need to do in order to make Jesus happy. But if you are reading the letter in total, if you are reading everything that John has to say, then it becomes crystal clear that John believes that God does absolutely everything. All of your forgiveness, all of your salvation is dependent entirely upon Jesus. And now as Christians, with the Holy Spirit dwelling within you, you are called to live a new life. You believe that you are passing through the darkness now, that your God has saved you from this sin-filled world. Now John calls you to live like you are passing through the darkness. He calls you to live as if that darkness is passing. And that's what's going to be at the heart of what we talk about here. So, in our very first section of John that we're going to take a few moments to look at today, just the first few verses, I just want to start with this one question. The main kind of closer for it is going to be these words, make our joy complete. And so, in fact, if you could turn to, actually, don't read it yet. Let's just ask this question. In the letter we're about to study, John says he's writing this to make our joy complete. This is John saying, my joy and your joy to make our joy complete. In your community, is Christianity known as a joyful religion? Why or why not? Is Christianity known as a joyful religion?
No.
Your community. In other words, our community here in Ottawa.
No.
It is not. Karen said it is not. Does anyone want to say, my experiences are different?
I think Christianity is the one that everybody likes to mock and make jokes about.
Yeah.
It's the safe one to make a joke about.
Yeah, it's very safe to make jokes about it, right? Yeah, it's the safest religion to make jokes about in our culture right now. Yeah. Does everyone basically feel like Christianity kind of does not have a reputation? If I were to give you three adjectives to describe Christianity. Your average Joe or Josephine off the street, would one of those three adjectives be joyful?
No.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of people think that religion is a cause of so many of the wars and things.
Yeah. Yeah, right. Religion is a cause of a great deal of suffering in this world. Yeah. Why? Why do you think people do not believe that Christianity is joyful?
Thought. Maybe we're not showing the joy that we should as saved people. People are not seeing it enough and saying, well, they're Christians, oh, they're hopeless.
Yeah, maybe we're not showing the joy. Yeah, good. Other thoughts?
We're very law-based. We come out very law-based. And people, when they think about Christianity, they just think, oh, the Ten Commandments, the 10 things that you have to do that we can never do.
Yeah.
Not the joy.
Yeah, right. If you asked the average person, what do you know about Christianity, they would probably mention two things. One, there was a guy named Jesus, and Christians believe in the Ten Commandments, right, or something like that, right? Two primary things. And if you were to ask them, well, what did Jesus do, they would probably say, and most of the non-Christians I've talked to would say, Jesus, what? Besides dying on the cross, what did he do for you and me? Why is he useful to history and society?
He's a good example.
He's a good example of keeping those Ten Commandments, right? And that's kind of the sum of it, right? So it's very kind of law-driven, right? Yeah.
I think more and more people don't even know that.
Yeah.
They don't even know who Jesus is.
Yeah.
They know the word. They use the word. Wrongly.
Yep.
But they have no idea what it's about.
Yep.
I think for the most part, what they think Christianity is about is what they read in the news.
Yeah.
The heinous things that have happened.
Yeah. Right. And maybe Jesus is relegated to Muhammad and other kind of figures floating out there. Yeah. Yeah. Good. Other reasons why people might not. Why people have the impression that Christianity maybe is not joyful. That's not the first thing that comes to their mind. Yeah.
Well, there's always the example of the Catholic Church.
Yeah.
That's in the news, frequently.
Yeah.
So, you have the money in Rome, you have the abuse by the priests, you have all the bad press about, and of course the Catholics are the one that seem to stand out for Christianity in the world. And so when something bad happens, we're all labeled under the same scenario. Yeah.
Yeah. And when you talk to people that were raised Catholic, and you ask them, what do you remember about your Catholic upbringing or your Catholic school, is joy usually the first thing?
No.
That comes to mind?
Guilt.
Yeah, guilt, right? Very guilt-driven, right? Yeah. What does it take for a Christian to say, I have a joy-filled life? What does it take?
Love and trust in God, because if you trust him, no matter what you have, you believe he's giving you the best.
Yeah.
And he's going to take care of you.
Yeah, right. The joy of knowing that you're his child, and if you're his child, he's watching over everything, right? Good. Other things. Where else does the Christian's joy come from? What gives you the ability to say, I have a joy-filled life? You lost your job, death in the family, how can you say I've got a joy?
Well, for me, being sick and all, I know my future.
Yeah.
And that brings me a lot of joy. So, and it almost doesn't make you scared.
Yeah.
So, and it's, so it's in that way, I'm joyous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and what we're going to see here, oh, go ahead.
Well, I'm thinking of funerals. In our churches, there is such peace and joy.
Yeah.
Mixed in with the grief, but the joy is predominant. And when you go to other churches, there's nothing there like that. There's no comfort.
Yeah. Yeah, it's huge. Yeah.
Speaking honestly, I don't know if I have achieved the point yet where it's joy. It's comfort, but I still am bothered by pain and such. So you gotta really push me to say, yeah, this is joy filled, because I am at peace because I know where I'm going, but I'm not necessarily thrilled about experiencing pain.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's a work in progress.
Yeah, Yep, and so one of the ways that we're going to be looking at this joy is that not only is this a joy that is yours for the taking, so to speak, because of what Christ has done for you, but this is a virtue that Christians cultivate.
Yeah.
Right? It is not natural for sinful humans living in a world full of sin and grief and pain and hardships to be able to look at the silver lining, the gospel silver lining that Christ gives us. Right? And so this is going to be something to work for. And don't misunderstand me. John's point is not that Christians are going to always be giggling, right, for their entire lives, that you will always be loaded with nothing but good times, right, and feeling nothing but pleasure the rest of your life. That's not his point. His point is, do you feel, in general, as far as being a Christian and what your Savior has done for you, do you derive happiness from that, and does that happiness leak out into the rest of your life and into the people around you? That's the question that he wants us to struggle with at a certain point. So, with that in mind, we're going to just real quickly talk about John. What do you know about John? Disciple, right? So it's very possible that John, before he was a disciple of Jesus, was a disciple of John the Baptist, right? So we've got Brutal the Younger's John the Baptist here. Here's John the Baptist doing some preaching, getting ready to do some baptizing in a very German Jordan River Valley there. And,
doesn't look like that at all.
And we can imagine that somewhere in these crowds is John, that he first followed John the Baptist, and that in the very beginning of John's Gospel, the one that the John that wrote this letter also wrote, what's one of the first events that takes place in John's Gospel? What's that? Yeah, right. Or actually John recalling how he baptized Jesus. And what he's doing is he's got a few disciples around him, and Jesus pops up and he says, look, there's the Lamb of God, right? And so at that point, it says the disciples stopped following John and they began following Jesus. And it's very probable that this is one of those disciples was John, the disciple that wrote this thing here. And so John was not only with, possibly, John the Baptist, but we know that he was with John, or that he was with Jesus, his entire public ministry, as far as we can tell. That literally John was there for every major event that there were witnesses for in the New Testament, in the Gospels there. That he was front and center for them all. In fact, he was not just one of the 12, but there's another group that John belongs to. Out of the 12, there were three, right? There was kind of this inner three, so to speak, that Jesus would from time to time take aside to talk with and to pray with and to maybe show some very special things to. And who were those three? Peter, James, and John. Right? And so John was one of them. And so we're talking about things like the transfiguration of Jesus, which is something that only two other humans other than John, the disciple, got to witness. So he was there for absolutely everything. John, when you see him in art, how is he usually pictured? There's a telltale way of being able to know which one is John.
Usually one sitting beside Jesus with love in his eyes.
All right, so he's the one that's, like, we know that he's always sitting at the right of Jesus at the Lord's Supper, right? And what's different about the guy that's sitting to the right of Jesus compared to all the other, don't look at this person, but compared to all the other ones? Usually everyone else has beards, because in this time, if you were over the age of 20, you'd grow that beard. This is just a sign of manhood. John is the one that never has a beard. Why does he not have a beard?
So we know he's John.
No. So we know he's John. Yeah. Why does he not have a beard? He's the youngest disciple as far as we know. He was definitely young. So we're thinking maybe even 18, 19 years old when he begins following Jesus. Maybe he's not that young, but he's definitely a young man. at this time. And so in art, he's always pictured without the beard compared to, right, we got a nice big hipster beard there. But yeah, no beard. So that's how we can tell a picture of him. So yeah, he's there for Lord's Supper, obviously, and he's sitting right next to Jesus. He's the one that Jesus whispers to a bunch of times. This is Rembrandt's denial of St. Peter. Can you recall the story of St. Peter denying Jesus? So Jesus is on trial with the Jewish leaders, and in the courtyard, there's Peter, and then there's also one other disciple that knew some of the people there that were able to get them kind of in the area where Jesus is on trial. It's very probable, many historians and theologians say, we don't know 100%, but it's very probable that that person was also John. That John was the one that was there witnessing Peter do his denials. And also was very physically in proximity, one of the closest disciples with Jesus throughout his trials as well. And he's kind of following along. This is a painting by John Tissot, which is a, can you tell what it's a picture of?
Yeah, Jesus on the cross.
Yeah, Jesus is on the cross, and you're looking down from Jesus' perspective, right? How many disciples were at Jesus' crucifixion? Out of the 12? As far as we know? One. We only really know of one that was there, the disciple whom Jesus loved. And so out of everyone that Jesus looked down from, all of his 12 were gone, except for John there. And do you remember what Jesus said to John at that point? Yeah, right. He says, behold your mother. He points to John, says, John, behold your mother. And then to the mother, mother, behold your son. So in other words, John was given the charge, so to speak, from Jesus, from the cross, to watch out over Mary. So think about this disciple. Talk about being connected to Jesus and his ministry and Jesus' life. He is there. On the forefront for everything. He heard Jesus speak a lot. And then after Jesus' death, which one do you think's John? Yeah, right? So here we've got Peter and John, and they are the first two out of the 12 disciples to go to the tomb, to witness the empty tomb. There's some women before them, but this is all, again, just to say that John is intimately connected into the events of Jesus' passion and resurrection, that he's right there recording this all. In John's gospel, it says, this is the disciple who has seen and testified to these things, you know, to this empty tomb. It's just wonderful stuff. After Jesus' ascension, then, John is there at Pentecost when they receive the special gift of the Holy Spirit. And so is there a beardless guy there? For some reason, a lot of people like to put Mary in the picture of Pentecost. She's very often there, even though she's not mentioned by name as being there. That's Mary Magdalene, I should say. I don't see a beardless. Oh, maybe this guy here. Maybe that's what's going on. I don't know. But he's there. He receives the gift of the Holy Spirit. And then he, along with Peter, they're the two then that are performing miracles in Jerusalem following Pentecost. So they are the two main public figures being identified as followers of Christ at the birth of the Christian church. There's no question that Peter is the more vocal one out of the two. We've got more recorded about what he says and does, but John's right there beside him for most of it. He gets thrown into prison, beaten, scourged with Peter as well for preaching about Jesus. So he's right there, and again, now he looks like he's, I don't know, 15 right there. A 60-year-old, 60-year-old Peter. After Pentecost, then, within the next few years, there's a major persecution that breaks out in Jerusalem by the Jewish people against these new Christians, and because of that, there's a scattering that takes place, the disciples, now apostles, end up kind of going out in different corners. This is a map I started putting together for the trips of Paul, all of those cities, the ones identified, are ones that are mentioned by name, places that he visited. But this is also a good kind of picture of how the early church kind of spread out. In Jerusalem, major centers began being formed in Alexandria, in Antioch up here, in Ephesus, in Corinth, and in Rome up there especially, but also other places. Thessalonica up here, where we have our letter to the Thessalonians, Philippi, our letter to the Philippians, Ephesians then. John ends up in Ephesus as later on in life. And so if you take a look at page 2, I've got a timeline there of you, of John's life. And so after the Jerusalem Council in 49, we know that he's present there. After that, at some point he becomes the bishop in Ephesus. And there he trains two very famous early church fathers, Polycarp and Ignatius of Antioch. So two very famous people that we have lots of their works, their early Christian writings. He, according to tradition, was the teacher of those two guys, and he's bishop in Ephesus for a very long time after that. At some point, he gets exiled to the island of Patmos. This is probably 95 AD when this happens. So even though he has no beard, he's an old man at this point, and he probably does have a beard, but we're still not going to draw him with a beard. But he's getting old at this point, and so there's a lot of tradition kind of around how this ends up happening. This is not in the Bible any way, shape, or form, but the traditional story is that there's a widespread persecution in Ephesus. John is thrown into the middle of an arena, and in that arena he is then thrown into a boiling pot of oil, but he comes out unscathed. And so the leader is so angry at this, at his plans of martyring John not working, that he gets exiled to Patmos. So that's the traditional story that's attached to it. I've got no idea how much of that is factual at all, but the early church believed that that was most likely what happened to John. Either way, he ends up on the island of Patmos while he's there. What happens? Yeah, right? He's writing something down here. So the Holy Spirit, Jesus appeared to John, and he receives the book of Revelation while he's on the island of Patmos. He leaves the island 98 AD, so he's there for 3 years, and he dies sometime shortly after that. So that also makes him the only one of the 12 disciples that was not martyred, that died of natural death. So he was a bishop for a very long time, and he had a major reputation in the early Christian church because he was the only surviving of the apostles into old age. So that's the life of John. Again, Jesus' ministry, he witnesses everything. This guy is at everything, and he becomes bishop in Ephesus. During this period, 85 to 95, is when he most likely wrote 1st, 2nd, 3rd John and the Gospel of John. We don't know which one he did first. Most likely he wrote the three letters first, and then the Gospel came later, but we've got no way of knowing these things for certain. But he almost certainly wrote them first, before his exile to Patmos, and then, while he was on the island of Patmos, that's when he wrote Revelation. So why is he going to write this letter? There is a kind of famous incident that takes place in the town of Ephesus. There was a false teacher there named Cerinthius, and the early church fathers record one time in which John is in a bathhouse, and while he's in the bathhouse, there's people standing outside, and John runs out of the bathhouse, and he says, "We must flee this place. Cerinthius is there. We must flee before God strikes him dead," right, or something like that. So one of his arch enemies in Ephesus, according to early church tradition, was this guy named Cerinthius. And Cerinthius was what we would call a proto-Gnostic. Does anyone know what Gnosticism is? Gnosticism?
Gnosticism are, but the name comes from the Greek Gnosis, the idea of knowledge.
Yeah.
So there's certain knowledge that you can attain, but only certain individuals, probably through different acts, can attain that knowledge. So
yeah.
It's a hidden knowledge that the majority won't know.
Yeah.
Somehow you can get to it.
Yeah, good. So if you remember, like, Da Vinci Code, things like that, full-fledged, blown-up Gnosticism was not Christian in any way, shape, or form, but they created these weird books like the Gospel of Judas and the Gospel of Thomas, and the idea of it was you had to master secret knowledge that could only be imparted to you in a very special way, and there were different kind of levels, it was kind of Masonic in a sense, these different levels of understanding that you could achieve. But that doesn't come for another 100 years, 150 years from now. Before all that, though, there's this thing called proto-Gnosticism or incipient Gnosticism, where some of these ideas are starting to get batted around, and Cerinthius certainly taught some of this stuff. So it's possible that John is writing this letter because he is trying to ward off or trying to address this Cerinthius or some type of what we call proto-Gnostic thoughts that are in it. What's definitely going on is that there's a group that has left this Christian group that denies that Jesus is the Christ or the Son of God, denies that Jesus rose from the dead. They didn't accept Jesus' teaching and binding, and there's some type of lack of brotherly love that is being addressed in some way, shape, or form. We could add a fifth bullet to that. They totally denied that Jesus was that he came in human flesh, that he was a human being, a real human being, in some way, shape, or form. So that's all kind of boiling around there. And what I would like us to do with, how much time do we have? With about 2 minutes here, is at your tables, identify, first of all, the person that that traveled the furthest for the holidays, and the person that traveled the least furthest for the holidays, least furthest from this point right here in this room. All right. The person that traveled the furthest is going to be your reporter. The person that traveled the least is going to be the person that made your task done. Right. Now, what I want you to do is, at your table, you've got a quote from the first few verses of 1 John 1, and then the first few verses of John 1, so the gospel that he wrote. All right, so on the left is the first lines of 1 John. On the right, the first lines of the Gospel of John. What evidence is there that the same person wrote both? Okay, come up with three similarities or shared themes between the two of them. And then if you've got time, what are all the names in the scripture John uses for Jesus in these opening verses, in both of them? What's he trying to stress about Jesus by using these? All right, you've got 5 minutes tops. We'll say four. Okay, go. Read the things out loud, though, all right? Read 1 John 1 and read John 1.
That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at, and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it and testified to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete. Excellent. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. To all who received Him, to those who believed in His name, He gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, nor a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is of the Father's side, has made Him known.
Thank you. Three items that you think is the same writer.
Starts the same.
Yeah.
But it talks about how, like, this story sort of starts in the beginning of time. like Jesus's kind of group.
They both talk about being children of God or in fellowship with God.
You know, there's the kind of fellowship, I think. Yes.
Fellowship or family.
Yes.
Okay. Maybe, like.
Seconds. Yeah, it's like a reporter or witness.
Mm-hmm.
Evidence is there that the same person wrote both? Three similarities, shared themes between 1 John 1 and John 1 here. Besides the title, very well done.
It's almost like the set structure of the miracle on it.
Yes. Okay, so there's definitely a style, like the actual linguistic style, we could say. So, yeah, what particularly about it?
It's all about the poem.
Yeah. John is known for having the easiest Greek in the New Testament. So he is the easiest to read. He uses a very limited vocabulary. But he is known as the most deepest, deepest out of all of them, that he writes about the most abstract things in Scripture, the most poetic with his use of words. And so because of that, you put those two things together, you got something very special with John here. And you just read the two of them, and it just feels the same, doesn't it? Besides the actual subject matter.
The metaphorical use of the metaphor.
Yeah.
Never refers to Jesus as the Son of God or whatever. It's always the word that which was. It's a metaphorical perspective.
Yeah. So 1 John, how long does it take before he uses the name Jesus? It's not until the very end that he has all these other ways of describing and naming Jesus. And what's wonderful about John chapter 1 is that you've got a long time before the name of Jesus actually happens. Instead, John tells us what Jesus' name was before he was named Jesus by Mary and Joseph. What was his name?
The Word.
Yeah, have the Word, right? Isn't that a cool name, right? So his name was the Word, and so John talks about the Word, the Word, the Word, the Word, the Word, and then the Word became flesh, right? And then all of a sudden we can talk about Jesus, right? But yeah, so you've got that same thing going on in both. What else? Other similarities?
The testimony that Jesus is part of the Trinity and was there at creation.
Yeah, Trinity. So where do you see the Trinitarian type language in here? Yeah. Right. So especially this union or unity between the Son and the Father. Right. This is a major part in both. Right. So he was with God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only who's at the Father's side, has made him known. Like, unpack that for a minute. Do you see what he's saying here? No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only who's at the Father's side. Who's at the Father's side? Jesus. So he's literally calling Jesus, God, the one and only here, has made God known, right? And what do we have in John 1 here? But we've got very similar things, right? Our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. The life appeared, right? So there's this unity language that's definitely in both, right? That which was from the beginning. So why in the world would John, in both of his writings here, begin with this language about the beginning?
It's stating who Jesus really is.
Yeah.
He is God. He was there from time of creation, and he's here now.
Who's the only person that's around before creation? Who's the only person that we can say is at the beginning of all things?
God,
right? And so this is the language that he's using to describe God. And so it's kind of interesting because he says that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we've looked at and our hands have touched. Who's the that and the which referring to? Jesus, right? Jesus was what was from the beginning. Jesus is who we've heard. Jesus is who we've seen with our eyes. And so he's got this beautiful way of talking about Jesus without actually mentioning him, but by starting with his deity, right? With him being God. Good. Other things. Cool. Connections, yeah.
Jacob and I like the correlation between 1 John verse 2 and the Gospel of John verse 14.
Yeah. Yeah, isn't that cool? The life appeared. We have seen it and testified to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. And then, the Word became flesh, made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only from the Father, full of grace and truth. Right? And so the major tie between the two is John is saying this thing that was around from the beginning, that created the universe, I've seen him. We've seen him with my own eyes. I've looked upon God, right? And then he's going to begin describing who this God is. It's Jesus. Good. Yeah, so we've got 30 seconds. Both refer to Jesus as the Word. Did you notice that? So the name for Jesus in both is the Word. Both emphasize Jesus' humanity. Our hands have touched him. Right? So you can touch this God. Both emphasize John as witness to the incarnation. Both mention God bringing together Christians. Did you notice that? So you got fellowship being mentioned here, right? And then becoming children of God, the family of God, and the separate one as well. So you've got this God who is from eternity that has become flesh, has now brought us together into a family of God. Right? What are all the names and descriptors John uses for Jesus? The Word of life, the Father's Son, Jesus Christ, right, is used as well, right, in the beginning here, Jesus, with his Son, Jesus Christ. So again, you just have Jesus, or John stressing as much as possible, right, that this Jesus is everything. Not only is the world created through him, but life. The life that you and I have, the only source of life, comes from this Jesus. So very, very powerful words to be able to do. All right, we're going to have to stop there. We will... touch on a couple cool things next week. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We thank you that you have given us your Word. You have given us Scripture where we get to read the very words coming from those who have heard and those who have seen and those who have touched you. And their witness, their message is clear. Life only comes from you. You are the source of everything that we need. And because of that, we can say that we have assurance about the future. We have a true source of joy, a joy that will never perish, that will never fade, because forgiveness cannot be taken away. Eternal life cannot be taken away. It's all found in you. Thank you. Bring us together now.